नमस्कार जी डॉक्टर अनुराग। जी
सो वी आर लाइव नाउ।
सो वी कैन स्टार्ट आई थिंक।
यस सर, वी हैव ब्रॉडकास्टेड द वेबिनार।
फाइन। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द इंडियन मेडिको लीगल एंड एथिक्स एसोसिएशन आई वेलकम ऑल द एस्टीम्ड पार्टिसिपेंट्स। आई वेलकम टुडेज स्पीकर डॉक्टर शिव कुमार एफ कुंबर। आई वेलकम डॉक्टर अनुराग वर्मा, द सेक्रेटरी ऑफ द इंडियन मेडिको लीगल एंड एथिक्स एसोसिएशन। एज वी आर ऑल अवेयर दैट वी आर पासिंग थ्रू द ग्रेटेस्ट ट्रेजेडी ऑफ दिस लास्ट 100 ईयर्स, प्रोबेबली मोर देन द वर्ल्ड वॉर्स फर्स्ट एंड सेकेंड। मोर पीपल हैव डाइड इन कोविड देन इन द वर्ल्ड वॉर्स and we don't know when this will end, so we must be updated all the time about all the pros and cons, highs and lows of this tragic situation. Today Dr. Shiv Kumar Kambar is going to speak about medical legal and ethical aspects of COVID. So I welcome all of you again, and I invite Dr. Anurag Verma, the secretary, to introduce Dr. Shiv Kumar and other formalities. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I welcome you, President of Hiblia, and Dr. Shiv Kumar F. Kumbar, sir, for this web lecture of Indian Medico Legal and Ethics Association. I welcome all the viewers also. Let me introduce Dr. Shiv Kumar F. Kumbar, sir, to the audience. Dr. Shiv Kumar Kumbar, sir, is an honorable member of Indian Medical Legal and Ethics Association, and he is present here in the capacity of advisor to Hiblia also. Now, today evening, he is going to deliver a lecture on the topic Medical Legal and Ethical Challenges during COVID-19 Era. Dr. Shiv Kumar Kumbar, sir, has done his MBBS from Gulbarga. He has done his DA from Shimoga in 1994. He is an LLB, LLM, and he has done PGDMLS and PGDMLE also from Pune and Bangalore. He has done MBA in hospital administration also, and he is a fellow of Indian Academy of Medical Specialties. He has been vice president of IMA Karnataka State 2016 to 2017. He has been vice president of ISA Karnataka State Chapter 2019-20, and he is a member of Standing Committee of Legal Cell of IMA Headquarters. By profession, he is a consultant anesthesiologist, and he is a well-known medical legal advisor, and he is a very good pain and palliative care therapist. So we are very honored, sir, and we are very lucky to have you as a speaker in this evening. On this evening, on behalf of Hiblia, and to deliver this first web lecture in this series. I welcome you, sir. Please deliver your talk, sir. You're welcome. Dr. Kumbar, sir. Dr. Kumbar, sir, can you... listen to me. You can start your talk, sir.
I think due to some internet problem, she has left the webinar.
Okay, we should wait for that. We should wait for that problem to get over.
Dr. Satish, sir, is there. I welcome Dr. Satish Tiwari also, the founder of Hiblia. Sir, are you there?
Just to fill in the gap, sir, I would like to say something.
Yes,
that,
please.
During these COVID times, what every medical professionals, they are quite well aware of. Doctors are working day and night, and they are treating the COVID patients, especially the frontline doctors and the healthcare workers. And they are treating the patients even after recognizing the difficulties of the rest to their life and to the life of their families also. And they are working in this environment day and night up to their full capacity and in good faith. And even then, they are actually in fear of getting medical legal cases filed against them by some patients. And patients, they also know this thing very well. But even after knowing this, many patients are not actually able to restrict them to hold the doctors negligible for their treatment. And some FIRs and cases are still being filed. And these have been filed recently. So IMLIA, as an association, and with help of other medical specialties associations and even IMA, it has taken up the issue. And IMLIA is committed to get an ordinance drafted or promulgated from the government to the effect that all the this claim liabilities as well as the FIRs which are filed over the doctors during this COVID period, those should be rejected, have been issued, and the doctors should be free of them.
Yes, there's a big danger looming on us, all of us, and we have taken the right step in this. And I spoke to the national president of Indian Medical Association, and he has also promised that they will also pursue this matter.
Okay, sir.
Dr. Shiv Kumar has joined with his presentation. So over to Dr. Shiv Kumar, sir.
Good evening, Dr. Mukul, Dr. Anurag, Dr. Satish.
Good evening, sir.
Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity. Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to share my views on a very important topic. Rather, I would say, in due course of time, it's going to be a burning topic, because medical professionals in India are yet to learn many things from this COVID era. In this construct, what I'm trying to tell today is medical, legal, and ethical challenges in COVID era, which we are likely to face. So I believe in one thing, okay? Extraordinary times require extraordinary measures. In the meantime, we should not let people to die with their rights on. So, to begin with, in this context, there's no doubt that accelerating and increased spread of COVID pandemic led to the overriding axioms in the medical practice, which led emergence of the controversial medical legal issues, for which we have to dig out the possibilities how exactly we can defend ourselves in the days to come. This COVID-19 has heralded a wide set of challenges involving not only the medical management of the patient, but also we have a legal dilemma. The medical professionals have been caught in balancing their obligations and duties to their patients and their own rights to safeguard themselves, their family, and their establishments, including the staff. It is the need of the hour to be mindful of existing laws and our rights and duties in the era of current epidemic. Thus, the healthcare facilities grappled with constraints to restructure their existing edifices into COVID-19 zones. Thus, pushed the medical professionals changes in the clinical practice. While this pandemic is far over and is here to stay for a couple of years, it is essential that we all stay cognizant about the medical management and legal aspects intertwined with it. We all need to be mindful of legal aspects, fear, uncertainty, and distress in the epidemic outbreak. We have to preserve lives and prevent the pandemic spread while upholding the epidemic standards, ethical standards, which is the daunting task for all of us. Friends, unprecedented and unique medical legal scenarios have been the hallmark of medical care in COVID-19 times. In the urgency to provide optimum care while protecting the caregiver's health and elevating the research gains, medical legal compliance have utmost and acceptable norm nowadays. With this brief introduction, let us know moral, ethical, and legal standards which are challenging to us. In this context, medical care in times of pandemic is often compromised and constrained because of the following reasons. Constrained circumstances, yes, which are new to us. And patient confidentiality, unlike our regular practice, you have to be mindful of this patient confidentiality. And research countries are very, very important because we do not know what happened, and within the available resources, we have got to manage the cases in bulk. And informed consent is a little bit different take in our routine cases. And working outside the specialization also is very, very important because the specialized people may be plugged into the COVID era for the management of the needy patients. And remote consultations, telemedicines has come into picture, and enhanced cost of the medical care also we have to think, because we all know that because of the COVID era, the cost of the medical treatment has gone somewhere from 40% to the tune of 400 times, which we all know about it. So, as I said, we have got to be something like mindful of the legal framework. A medical professional, by virtue of powers vested in all of us because of our skills, knowledge, and training, and we are obliged to follow the ethical code of conduct, having accepted the medical profession as our profession. So, what are the medical professional rules for which we are bound? As you all know that we have some code of ethics one side and other regulatory mechanisms on the other side, and also the hanging sword on all of us is the violence on the doctors at any given point of time. Indian Medical Council, Professional Conduct, Etiquette and Ethics Regulation 2002 has certain guidelines for which we are bound by that. Section 2.1.1 deals with the duties of a physician for their patients on the obligation to sick. It clearly defines that no physician shall arbitrarily refuse treatment to any patient. We have to be very, very mindful of this, especially in this COVID era. Section 2.1.2 deals that the medical practitioner having any incapacity detrimental to the patient or which can affect his performance to profession. In this case, you must have seen many states have imposed 5 years, 60 years onwards may not practice in this COVID era. Section 5 also says physicians inform the health authorities of every case of communicable disease and his care, and enlighten the public about the quarantine regulations as which you have been doing for the last 1 year. Whenever an epidemic occurs, a physician should not abandon his duty for fear of contacting the disease. Many times, last year especially, everybody was scared to an extent that doctors shut down their clothes, They did switch off their mobiles and they were untraceable. They went to some remote places or the native places for want of safety. But this year, especially in second wave, most of the doctors were not scared. The only exception will be a situation where a physician himself has a medical condition which places him in a very high risk category. Upon exposure to the contagion, he himself can retire for the time being from the practicing of his profession. So, apart from the Medical Council of India rules and regulations, we have one more Epidemic Act of 1897. This act, a very small article, or very short, comprising of a couple of pages, which is 123 years old. Okay, in this act, there are certain things which we have to be mindful about that. The first three sections of the act elaborate measures to prevent and contain the spread of infectious disease and pronounce the punishment for disobeying the government orders given under this act. I'm not going to touch upon this. Section 4 of this act is very, very important for the doctors who are scared in this epidemic. It is truly applicable to the healthcare professionals and provide legal protection to every person who does any act in good faith. This section provides immunity from legal action for any healthcare worker acting against under the provisions of this act. One more act, this is Disaster Management Act 2005. Under Section 6 of this act, the government has the power of requisition of resources with any authority or person and their services also. The expenses and logistics of such services are borne by the authorities requisitioning the services. The government can call this acquire public or a private healthcare facility and convert it into the COVID-19 treatment zone. In this regard, almost all over hospitals in India, the Disaster Management Act is in force, and government or authorities in the district level have imposed very strict norms that all private hospitals should provide 50% of their bed. In certain states, I believe 20% of the beds also to the district administration are, they should be kept exclusively for the COVID case management. Apart from this Epidemic Act and the Disaster Management Act, we have a constitutional rights and safeguards also. Article 21 of the Constitution guarantees protection of life and personal liberty. Every individual enjoys certain fundamental rights. Part 3 of the Constitution. These rights are constrained or encroached. Anybody or citizen of India can go for the writ petition and public interest litigation to the High Court or the Supreme Court under Section 32. Article 21 thus provides ample protection to the healthcare providers to move the high judiciary if they are forced to work under the suboptimal conditions. So what are the suboptimal conditions? Last year, when this started, including all healthcare professionals, they work with or without the PPE kit, with or without the N95 mask, with or without the sanitizers. And they were forced to work because of the constraints. And this year, it's not so because we learned how exactly we should manufacture, how exactly we should use all the protective measures. And there is no depth of this kind of conditions nowadays. The recent promulgation of the ordinance to amend the ED Act 12 is a step to provide protection to the healthcare services personnel and the property from an act of violence during an epidemic, which I'm going to touch it shortly. The ordinance declares such acts of violence the cognizable and non-reliable offences and defines penalties for the same, which entail this such kind of antisocial elements. I would say that last year, even healthcare professionals were barred from occupying the rented house, and even healthcare workers in that particular residency level, they were not given a cooperation from the local people, and in many shops, they were not entertaining the healthcare professionals, thinking that he works in the COVID zone. Can a doctor refuse treatment of a COVID-19 patient? Yes. This is very often asked by healthcare professionals or from own colleagues. A medical practitioner who is qualified and has the basic infrastructure to treat a COVID-19 patient should not refuse unless his own health is prevent him from doing so, which he will be held responsible for the want of his commitment. Refusal to treat a COVID-19 patient for any other reason will amount to contravention of the regulations of Indian Medical Council regulations, which states precisely that physicians should not abandon his duty during the epidemic for the fear of contracting the disease. Implicit or explicit refusal to treat will amount to infringement of the Article 21 of the Constitution of India. Would failure to adhere to the government guidelines be treated as a negligence? Yes, failure to adhere to the guidelines would surely invite the wrath of government bodies and adverse legal consequences. Mr. B was to open his
I think due to some technical glitch, Dr. Shivakumar sir got disconnected. He will be joining us back soon. Thank you.
Sorry for the there was a technical glitch. Next. Yeah. What additional precautions to safeguard the interest of the medical practitioner? COVID-19 pandemic harassed the complex environmental situations, something that have not been experienced by anybody during their career. We need to religiously follow the guidelines issued by the statutory bodies. Sometimes we are caught in certain dilemmas, especially in ethical issues. The position statement released by the Indian Society of the Critical Care Medicine regarding the management of critically ill patients, for example, the COVID patients, once they are pushed into the severity, we are into dilemma. ICMR consensus guidelines recently released, that is 2020, that is do not attempt resuscitation, or DNAR, are valuable tools which provide guidance on the management of these complex clinical situations. For example, if the patient is 65 years, another patient is 35 years, if there is only one ventilator in that establishments, both of them need ventilator. How are you going to assess? You are caught in such situations. In this scenario, the ISCCM or the ICMM guidelines definitely are going to help you. As I said, you telemedicine guidelines, which are released and are practiced by most of the doctors in India. These telemedical guidelines have certain limitations, which I'm not going to touch upon because it's a different topic itself. And these guidelines are invaluable, especially in pandemic. But data breach and confidentiality issues may arise. Consent is also a bit difficult in practicing a telemedicine. Many times we are scared. District authorities or government officials or politicians, they scare medical professionals, stating that if you do not comply with the government norms, probably we will cancel your registrations. For which everybody doctor all over India, they are scared. Can they really do it so? The answer is no. Because medical registration is given by their respective medical councils after completing their undergraduate or the post registration. Having registered, he has a liberty to practice anywhere in India. So if anybody says that registration is cancelled, do not get scared of it. Because in the Epidemic Act, as well as the Disaster Management Act, nowhere is mentioned your license is cancelled. So Chapter 7 and 8 of the Indian Medical Council Rules and Regulations of 2002, they clearly mentions misconduct and disciplinary action of the registered medical practitioners. So if there is a misconduct which is brought to their notice, the respective medical council will not cancel, will give an opportunity or a show cause notice to attend to the medical council and give it an explanation. And if the medical council thinks so that there is a misconduct or misobedience or disobedience of the registered medical practitioner, they can warn him, they can suspend his license for a couple of years, which is notified to everybody in the leading newspapers as his registration certificate, and they can bar him practicing a medical practice. And even though it happens in the state medical council, he has an opportunity to appeal to the Medical Council of India, and also there is a judicial review also. I told you the informed consent. Unlike informed consent of what you routinely take in routine cases is a bit different in COVID era. In this, we need to take the travel history and the contact history. Earlier, he was in a positive state or negative state. Was he in isolation? And also, having admitted in the hospital, in due course of time, he would become positive at any given of time because the disease itself is like that. There may be chances after that, having admitted in hospital, I became positive. In this scenario, we may add certain things from the informed consent, which I have prepared it and I have circulated to the all hospitals wherever I go, and I will put it in this for the information of everybody. Can a government invoke Essential Service Maintenance Act in this scenario? No doubt, yes. Health service is one of the essential services. If a doctor, both government and private, refuse to provide health services because of a fear of disease, or for any reason, government can invoke Essential Service Maintenance Act on him. Any person suspected of having committed any offense under this act can be arrested by any police officer without warrant. So, with all this, probably patient or relative can knock the door of the following judicial bodies or administrative bodies: district administration, respective medical councils, civil laws, consumer laws, criminal laws, violation of the constitutional remedies. Probably many of us do not know COVID-19 is considered as an acute medical disease by the WHO, indicating that healthcare workers who are infected by COVID-19 in the workplace because of the shortage of safety or preventive measures should have a right to get compensation, rehabilitation, medical services because of this occupational incident. And also most of the hospitals established are governed by the Labor Acts, even though employees, they remain positive or negative, they are made to stay at home, and their salaries should not be waived off. They should be given full salary in spite of employees being not working in any of the establishments. There are certain ethical issues. Confidentiality, medical legally is known that of confidentiality, professional secrecy are to be maintained about the patient. But here, exceptions in COVID infection, because the physician has to inform the respective authorities and also the relatives of the patient to get them quarantined to prevent the spread of infections from that particular patient. And withholding and withdrawing the medical interventions is a ethical issue. And in India, we do not have a clear-cut guidelines, but ultimately, as I said, we may have to depend upon the guidelines or consensus opinion of the ICMR as well as Indian Society of the Critical Care Medicines, depending upon the situations. I'll just deal with a few of the cases. Private hospitals can't charge patients for beds twice in a day, just like what is being charged in the 3-star or 5-star hotels. Especially West Bengal Clinical Establishment Regulatory Commission issued fresh directives to all the private healthcare facilities, instruct them not to collect the bed charges from patients twice within 24 hours. They used to collect the hospital charges or bed charges just like check-in, check-out norms, what it happens in the hotels. The hospitals were charging the patients according to their check-out timings. If the patient takes admission in hospital in the middle of the night and eventually get released or gets away from within 24 hours, and the same limited period of time is made to occupy by somebody else, it means that within 24 hours, the same bed was utilized by two patients. It means that they are charging twice in a period of 24 hours, for which the West Bengal Clinical Establishment Regulatory Commission instructed not to do so in the hospitals. Why the government can penalize you for not wearing a mask in your car? This is very, very important. We are also not aware of this. Many times you drive a car, okay, we shut our windows in the car, but very rarely we use our mask, putting AC on. According to the COVID-19 guidelines issued by the various state governments, not wearing a mask while driving one's personal car attracts fine of 500. Many people question rationally or validity of these restrictions, thinking that private car is not a public space. It is a personal space. But in the case of Satvinder Singh versus State of Bihar, in this ruling, it is said that private cars which run in the public road can be deemed to be a public space. Therefore, any activity that is not permitted in a public space will automatically be impermissible inside the car. Smoking, drinking, obscenity are examples of the activities that could attract a penal provision when they are doing it in their own personal car, which is on a public road. It is true that the public may not have access to private vehicles as a matter of right, but definitely public have the opportunity to approach the private vehicle while it is on the public road. If anybody questions in this, rather than arguing with the police people, best thing is to pay the penalty, because the any amount of argument will not hold good as per the Satyajit Singh versus State of Bihar decision. Failure to provide hospitals to provide timely medical treatment is also a violation of the Article 21. The Patna High Court ruled it out. Article 21 imposes an obligation on the state to safeguard the right to life of every person. Preservation of life is paramount importance. The Patna High Court issued slew of directions, observing that the government hospitals, medical officers are duty bound to extend medical assistance, and failure on the part of even a private hospital to provide timely medical treatment to a person in need of such treatment results in the violation of his right to life. Many times, we say that even the hospital is full, some serious patient comes, who fail to provide hospital beds, stating that the beds are full. And the law says that life is very precious, preservation is paramount. At least make an attempt to save a life by referring him to the better hospital for his survival. Sometimes even oxygen, IV fluids, or some sort of things definitely will help, which is our bounded duty. Many times we come across violence on the doctors and the rest of research. In one case, a family vandalized a private COVID hospital after patient deaths, for which 60 people who were involved in that were booked and arrested. In Harshita's husband claimed woman died due to the medical negligence and the hospital had wrongly given her a treatment of COVID-19. She had not tested positive. The mob suddenly went into the rampage on the hospital premises, assaulted the staffers, doctors, and also assaulted the security with the oxygen cylinders. The police officials booked people under this, under IP section 43, for being part of the unlawful assembly, 147 for writing, 323 voluntarily causing hurt, section 427 for mischief causing damage to the property, section 506 criminal intimidation, 204B using obscene words on the staff, section 270 malign intent likely to spread the infection dangerous to life because they were not maintaining the social distancing, none of them with a mask. There was a huge mob, and ultimately police have to book under section 51 of the Disaster Management Act. COVID-19 victim family files police complaint. At least medical negligence in Ernakulam Hospital. What I said now, the doors are open for the patient who suffered COVID or relatives to knock the door of the justice. The brother of a patient who died due to COVID-19 filed a police complaint against authorities showing medical negligence, stating that there is a delay in shifting the patient for a ventilator, and also there is a mismanagement of the ventilators, and doctors were not present when he died. Kerala Health Minister Srimathi K.K. Shailaja has ordered an inquiry into the allegations of the medical negligence at the Ernakulam Hospital. The inquiry is still pending. In the eyes of the patient or the relatives, the patient was on a ventilator, which was not so. The patient was only with the assisted mode or non-invasive mode. They alleged that there was some problem with the ventilator, the patient died, which was not acceptable by the hospital administration or the duty doctor, the staff. But inquiry is pending. Complaint is lodged. In one of the hospitals recently in Kanpur, a booked COVID-19 positive judge failed to get the proper treatment. So look at the complaints, what they're being lodged, and they're accepted by the law enforcing authorities or investigating authorities. In this case, a judge who was tested positive, which went into the hospital along with the chief medical officer. The moment he went there, he was taken to the first floor or second floor in the lift. the lift was malfunctioned. It may happen for any given point of time. And he got stuck. Ultimately, he managed to come out after a while, but found that there was no doctor available for taking care of him. No specialist doctors were available to give him a treatment. He became very much annoyed. An FIR was lodged against the hospital manager, doctors, and the staff on duty under section 166, 188, 269, 270, 596, and section 2 of the Epidemic Disease Act. If the judiciary bodies are filing a case against the doctors, if they are instigating such kind of things, just because lift was malfunctioning, there was nobody to receive him. Look at the common man. How can they behave soon after this epidemic is over? This is very funny. In this, public is asking mandatorily install CCTV cameras in the ICU, ICCU. They so motto they file an interim application before the Gujarat High Court. A plea has been moved in the Gujarat High Court seeking directions of the state and the hospital authorities to mandatorily install CC cameras to ensure transparency between the hospital authorities and the patients, stating that it will be in the interest of stakeholders in the hospital. Most of the casualties occur in the ICU and ICCU. The applicants that this issue can be mitigated to some extent by putting the CC camera, and also makes authorities to be transparent enough to disclose the treatment modality what they were given. And also, patient would ask recording of this CC cameras, just like what they ask for the gyroscopies of the case paper. But public should be aware. Is it practical? Is it possible? Are you not coming in the way of the confidentiality and secrecy of the patient? The judiciary and the public should be mindful of this before they could make it as a mandatory. In one of the hospital, Ahmedabad hospital fined recently 77 lakhs for the negligence after the COVID patient dies. In this, is a very funny, already the order has been passed. In this case, patient was suffering from the COVID-19, was to be shifted to some other hospital for want of ventilator. They shifted into the hospital, but they could not open the hospital gate, which they call it as a corona gate. There's a delay of 20-25 minutes. That was the reason why the patient succumbed. So ultimately, the Ahmedabad Municipal Corporation imposed 77 lakhs rupees of fine, of which 25 lakhs liability on the hospital side. The board members of the hospital, who were 8 members, each 2 lakhs, about 16 lakhs altogether, and the 18 trustees in the hospital, 2 lakhs each trustee, 36 lakhs altogether, it came about 77 lakhs. Is a negligent spreading of the COVID-19 a crime? Yes, it is. According to the law, the disease is an injury, and whoever causes it intentionally is liable both in a criminal as well as a civil law. The crime is called as a public wrong, where the individual and the society are considered as the victims. The state on behalf of the society takes up the cause and prosecutes the culprit. Apart from this, the individual victim can simultaneously file civil litigation claiming compensation for the damage caused to him by the person who has spread this contagious disease. COVID-19 and the medical negligence litigations. Since it's a new disease, contagious disease, we do not know how exactly things are going to be in due course of time, how the complaints are going to be lodged on the doctors. It's very, very scary. we all are fighting for the immunity for the doctors and the establishments. No suit, no file should be filed, especially whatever the limitations they have. They have done their best, especially in COVID era. No case should be filed against the doctor establishments, whatever the lacunage in their practice, in the treatment profile, or administration in this COVID era. But the community, judiciary, should be mindful of the exigent circumstances, constraints, manpower, financial aspect. You are stretched more than what you are supposed to do. And also, anything good did in a good faith or timely management, they should be taken as Good Samaritan, which is enforced in India. Disaster Management Act, Section 73, and Epidemic Act, Section 4 or 5, clearly mandates that no suit can be filed against the doctors and establishments which they have done it in the good intention. And also, certain IPC sections also safeguard the interests of the doctors with consent or without consent, whatever they have done to the best of their ability. With this, I conclude my talk on this burning issue, how exactly we should overcome, how exactly we should treat, how exactly we are being governed by this acts. So this is for information of everybody. Thank you one and all.
Thank you so much. This session was definitely very knowledgeable and very informative. Verma sir, to take over the stage. Dr. Mukul sir, would you like to take over the stage?
Thank you very much, Dr. Kumbar sir, for giving a very detailed and very informative discourse on the topic of the challenges, ethical challenges and others in this COVID time. Now, I think after such a nice and detailed discussion from Dr. Kumbar, we all must be having lots of questions. So I'll request Dr. Anurag Verma to invite questions from the audience.
Yeah, I have a question. Thank you, Dr. Mukul Tiwari, sir. I have a question in my hand at the moment. And the person asked that, if Dr. Kumbar, am I audible to you?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah. This is a question from the audience, that if a hospital has admitted a patient looking its oxygen requirements and it is unable to provide oxygen which is required, is it a criminal negligence?
This is very commonly faced by any of the establishments in India. And for the this is a new thing, what you are facing it now. But in my knowledge, doctors or establishments are not the manufacturers of the oxygen. Okay? Since it's a state issue, government or administrative authorities are made responsible for that. In this connection, even in Karnataka recently, it's proved beyond doubt after inquiry, few of the patients died because there was an oxygen shortage in the few hospital when the COVID patients were admitted. So ultimately, doctors were not booked. So ultimately, the government announced some compensation to the victims. It means that the onus has taken place on the government, not on the hospitals or the doctors. So there cannot be a negligence on the part of the doctor But before admitting the patient, which he knows it, probably he should have made an effort for the enough supply of the oxygen. And also he should keep in touch with the admission authority and also inform the patient that, yes, there is a shortage of oxygen. At a given point of time, you may be shifted. The onus of supplying the oxygen to the hospital falls on the administrative, not from the doctors, because you are not the manufacturer of the oxygen.
Yeah, you are very right, sir. But what happens in practical situation? Actually, everyone wants to escape from the responsibility. And in this case, there was a regulation by the administration that the hospital has to provide for its need of oxygen coming 24 hours, what the oxygen status. So it is things are very difficult at the moment. And it is quite imperative for the, it's quite imperative for the hospitals to be very cautious in the present circumstances. And if the administration actually shuts from taking responsibility, then there is again there is danger of violence also in hospital. In a few hospitals, violence has taken place. So there is a need for a central electoral violence also for the people, for the doctors who are not registered as COVID treating COVID hospitals, or they are treating their COVID patients. Because the other hospitals that are designated for this treatment for COVID-19 are overburdened. Yeah, you are very right in your replies.
I would like to point out here that the rules are not clear right now. My point of view is that in future, we may yet see that the government puts the blame on the doctors for not having oxygen.
Things are becoming difficult and difficult by the coming days, and now there is a further rule has been added that oxygen plant is necessary for every hospital. In some states, it has been mentioned. For example, in case of Haryana, the government has said that the upcoming hospitals, they should be ready to come with this oxygen plant in their own hospital. Anyway.
For that, the hospital should have at least 200 beds.
In Uttarakhand, there was a proposal that hospitals which are of more than 30 beds, they should have a provision for this oxygen plant.
Okay. But I think we must caution the doctors that they should not depend on this, that because of epidemic and because of this extraordinary situation, if oxygen is not in their establishment, oxygen is depleted from the cylinders and they'll be safe. They should not think like that.
Yeah.
So they should take all the precautions. And what is Dr. Shiv Kumar's view?
Yeah, I agree with you, because if you look at the present Consumer Protection Act 2019, okay?
Yes, sir.
Especially unfair trade practice, okay? We don't know how exactly the judiciary is going to interpret it in due course of time, because I agree with you, no doubt about it, but it's a newer thing, how exactly the court interpretation will be there, and how exactly our medical fraternity condemns, how exactly we defend, it also makes a much more interesting in the due course of time. So probably you have to be strong enough to mitigate this kind of litigations. Okay, where doctors are made accountable for oxygen, and it is going to be a hallmark in the days to come. So we have to be united. We should fight for this. It is not the doctor's job to provide the oxygen. It is the government administration, because health is a state issue.
Sir, there was disturbance of great magnitude today evening. Dr. Kumbar sir also had to stop, or his talk was stopped by the internet connectivity. And there was a lot of disturbance in as far as audience is concerned. So we are not able to get more questions from the audience. And whatever you say, Dr. Mukul Tiwari sir, for continuation of this lecture.
I can see some questions in the chat box. So please address those questions at least.
Okay.
Yeah, please.
Let me see.
You can see the chat box. There is one question that patient has tested positive after death. Patient was operated for incomplete abortion in emergency. Patient had convulsions in ward. Ward resuscitated and shifted to ICU in other hospital. She died 24 hours later. RT-PCR report received after death. So this is just, they are reporting. There is no question in this. What is the question here? I repeat here, sent by Dr. Ramesh Patel. Sent by Dr. Ramesh Patel. Again, listen, patient has tested positive after death. Patient was operated for abortion in emergency, had convulsions, was resuscitated and shifted to ICU and other hospital. She died 24 hours later. RT-PCR report received after death. So in this statement, there is no question itself. So we can leave it. There is a question that supply of industrial oxygen.
This is a question.
Yeah, this is a question. Supply of industrial oxygen by administration to hospital is crime or not? So, Dr. Kambar, please.
Yeah, because there is a hypothesis that mucormycosis, which is going on these days, that is because of industrial oxygen. Yes, sir, please.
Yeah, for a want of oxygen in this acute crisis, okay, so administration, no doubt about it, they're trying to come over the crisis, they have supplied the industrial oxygen, okay, and even if it is not being provided, probably casualty would have been much more what they're expected. So it has tried its best to overcome the situation by providing industrial oxygen, and it's a new thing that mucormycosis has been, because of that, still they have to establish the cause of mucormycosis, not necessarily industrial oxygen. There are so many things which causes the mucormycosis, immunocompromised patients, diabetes, and we all consider that steroid is a drug of choice, especially for the moderate to severe. So all must have been contributed to the mucormycosis, including the humidifier, what exactly we use in our day-to-day practice. So it's a new thing, we're yet to learn out of it, but it's not a crime, that's per my knowledge.
Okay, thank you very much. Any other questions from the audience? We are waiting. Dr. Anurag ji, you Dr. Ramesh Patel is reporting that the case which he had mentioned about that lady whose RT-PCR was positive, and a patient died after an incomplete abortion. So he's reporting that a patient's relatives did violence in the hospital. That's nothing. It is just unruly behavior. For just any reason, they will do violence. Okay, any other question? Dr. Anurag, how much time?
I don't see any other questions, sir. Time is 9 p.m.
We can close?
Yeah, we can close the session, because today evening there was a lot of this disturbance as far as internet is concerned, and I'm sure because of this only, many participants there were not able to join. Messages were coming that we are not able to join. Anyway, but this will be recorded and can be made available on YouTube.
If they have any questions, okay, they can text you. I can forward the same to me so that individually I can do my best to answer the queries.
Yeah.
One answer to Dr. Ramesh Patel's question, he has asked for the same question, that will Epidemics Act be applied? The relatives did violence. So Dr. Shiv Kumar, what is your answer?
Yeah, it does apply. It does apply. No doubt about it. Okay. They can be booked under this Epidemic Act. Yeah. Manhandling, abusing, and intimidating, whatever it is. Okay. It's a non-bailable and a cognizable offense. It can be booked. No doubt about it.
Fine. So, very nice, Dr. Anurag. Please proceed.
Yeah, so we are approaching the close of this session. And I thank Dr. Kumbhar sir for a very nice and elaborative talk. And the participants which were able to connect to the this session, they must have been benefited a lot. And the people who could not connect, they will be benefited. I am very sure about it by the when the, this talk is uploaded on YouTube. So I should again thank Dr. Shivkumar Kumbhar sir for his nice talk, Dr. Mukul Tiwari sir for being present as president of Himalaya, and our team of this platform, Dr. Mayuri and Dr. Samiksha for their presence over here and for nicely conducting this talk. And I now disperse the meeting. And in upcoming days, we are planning many such sessions, and this will be a regular feature of IMLIA as far as this web lectures are concerned. And very learned members, senior members, which we have in IMLIA all across the country, they will address the audiences, and the audience will be benefited. And this will help a lot as far as their medical practice is concerned. I'm very sure about it. Thank you very much. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, sir. I would just like to tell all the participants and panelists that this webinar has been recorded, and the recording will be available in 2 to 3 days on Medical Learning Hub platform. All the registered participants will be informed about the same via emailers. So, and the recording will also be uploaded on YouTube, and we will share the link with all of you about that also. And for the participants, we are raising a post poll. I would like it would be nice if all the participants take that poll, and panelists want, they can leave. We will be here for 2-3 minutes for all the participants to take the poll, just general, and give us their valuable feedback. That's it. Thank you. Sir, we will be up for another 2 to 3 minutes for all the participants to take the poll. And if you want to leave or anything, you can. We will be here. Not a problem. Thank you. I request all the participants to please take the poll that we've just raised. This will be a valuable feedback for us, and it will help us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Yeah.
Namaste. Doggy aa gaya.
Thank you so much, sir. We are closing the poll now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.